Please welcome the President and CEO of the National Marine Sanctuary Foundation, Joel R. Johnson. Hello.
How are you all? Good afternoon, and welcome back to Capitol Hill Ocean Week 2024. We have had a wonderful morning of incredibly inspiring as well as informative sessions on a wide array of issues facing our oceans, our Great Lakes, and coastal communities. We heard very brave discourse on how we need to be more courageous, how we need to be more urgent, and how we need to come together to collaborate, to take action. And across the many strategies and tactics that you heard from the wonderful panelists that were on our two plenaries, we covered subjects like tapping into youth culture and using art and education, seeing our aquaria and zoos as sources of inspiration to connect scientific research and public engagement. And of course, first thing this morning, you heard the very exciting news, the announcement of the 16th new National Marine Sanctuary, Lake Ontario National Marine Sanctuary. And once again, I just want to thank all of the folks who worked on that over a decade of work, as well as all of our distinguished panelists from this morning. We are looking forward to an exciting afternoon where we're going to cover topics on workforce development, the people power of youth leadership, and community stewardship. And then we're going to have some fantastic opening remarks and closing remarks as well. So I hope you had a good lunch, and I know that everyone's still buzzing from the news. The conversations that also took place virtually included conversations on North Atlantic right whales and how we can work to conserve that critically endangered species, the High Seas Treaty, as well as the discoveries along the Blake Plateau. These are great conversations, and I know they've got all of your wheels turning, certainly mine. The next topic is a critical one. Knowing the profound changes that are here for our oceans and our waterways, how will we prepare and support the next generation? That and more is the subject of our next plenary, People Power, Fueling the Future of Youth Leadership and the Marine Workforce. Our next session's moderator is Suraida Nañez-James. Suraida is the founder and CEO of the Gulf Reach Institute. She is a marine ecologist, a STEM entrepreneur, and a devout ocean lover. With over 18 years of experience in STEM education and science communication, she's directed a wide variety of education programs, led ocean explorations, and studied the Gulf of Mexico's ecology and culture. She serves on several boards focused on STEM education and diversity in ocean sciences, and has dedicated her efforts to educating communities about the Gulf's ecology, economy, and culture. Please welcome to the stage Suraida Nañez-James.
Hi, everyone. Hola. Talofa.
Aloha.
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 So thank you so much for being here today. We have a great conversation that hopefully will happen. And for all of the students, I was a teacher for a long time, so I know you still have your cell phones. So if you're going to text, maybe text all of the other youth to come and be part of this conversation so that they can have their voices heard, right? We often say that our voices are not heard, so we have to be in the room so those voices can be heard. We're here to change the narrative of what a leader looks like. You see this panel up here? All of these individuals that you'll get to meet in just a second are individuals that are not only passionate, but they're dedicated to making sure that youth, that all of you, I'm gonna make you stand up in just a second, so that they can see who you are. They're dedicated to making sure that you have the resources that you need, the skills, and then also to listen, which is a huge skill for anybody, to listen to what you have to say. So if you do have questions along the line as we're going through these, some of them have been submitted already, feel free, you have the little cards where you can put those questions down. Also, I just wanted to say just a little bit, I know Joel did a great one. I always get self-conscious when I get up here. So if there's any Latinos out there, I have my concha earrings. And if you know anything about conchas, I always say it helps me to be a little bit less self-conscious. And it kind of reminds, so if you see me touching it, it kind of gets me nervous. So I'm just kind of touching a little bit. But again, all of these people have spent a lot of time preparing and have a lot to share with you. But again, this is about you, the youth. So if you are considered youth, stand up so we can see who you are. You gotta stand up. Now just raise your hand. I see you. I see you, Puerto Rico. Oh, and Finn too. Finn's gonna introduce him. He's youth as well. Just like other individuals said, I have obviously not a youth. And if you think I am, more to you, I would have given you an A in class if you said that. All right, let's get started. So what I'm going to have is each of you introduce yourselves so that your name, your organization, and a little bit about what you do so everyone here knows what to ask. All right, go ahead.
My name is Finn Yemini. I'm a member of the Stellwagen Bank National Marine Sanctuary Advisory Council. I'm here to kind of talk about, obviously, youth involvement and how I have been, how that has changed my life and the opportunities I think that other youth like me can take to get involved in similar situations. Outside of that work, I also am involved in a local research institution in my town. We do research in our harbor and all sorts of ocean ecology work.
Very nice. I'm impressed. Are you impressed? I'm impressed.
Hi, I'm Marie Walker. I'm the Chief Operating Officer for the Corps Network. The Corps Network is a membership association of service and conservation corps from across the country. We serve about 25,000 young people just like you, working on service projects from public lands to recycling centers to working on trails to help maintaining parks. So those young people do a lot of things that I'm excited about, because I'm excited about the future. Because I know that we talked about people power, I think we need to add another word to that. Young people power.
Yeah.
Woo! Aloha mai kako, o Kawika Riley ko'u inoa, ku'u oneha nau ma moku o keawe, noho au ma kaimuki. Hi everybody, my name is Kawika Riley. I'm the Vice President of External Affairs at a sustainability-focused youth conservation nonprofit called Kupu. We're a member of the CHOW Network, which is the organization that Marie just introduced herself as being the Chief Operating Officer of. Kupu, you know, those of us who have the privilege of leading the organization today, we're not youth anymore, but Kupu is a youth-focused and youth-founded organization. Our three founders, they came back to Hawaii from college, and they didn't see, you know, they wanted to spend their career in conservation, in sustainability, in making their home a better place, and they didn't see an organization that fit that vision. So instead of settling for something else, they created what they wanted to see in their future. And, you know, today, over 20 years later, we run a variety of programs. We do education-focused things, also national service, and run a number of our states' green job and youth conservation opportunities. Really looking forward to the conversation with everyone up here today, and definitely the questions from all of you. Mahalo.
Hey, everybody. Great to be here. It's about 80% humidity outside, so you're in the right place here, nice and comfortable. My name is Brandon Levy. I'm the Chief Program Officer at Sustainable Ocean Alliance, SOA, as I'll call it shorthand. Was founded here actually at Georgetown University 10 years ago by Daniela Fernandez, who's the founder and CEO, as just when she was a freshman, 19 years old. And she went to a UN meeting, saw she was the only young person there, wanted to do something about it, and wanted to shift the narrative to be, rather than let's just get all the science correct about the problem, let's start taking action and let's have that action be youth-led and entrepreneurial in spirit. So I came on and joined Daniela right as she graduated college and been involved now for about 6 years at the organization, Today, we have the world's largest ocean-focused youth network. We have young people in over 165 countries, 6,000 or so young people taking action, and we provide small grants. We provide investment for those that are looking to create startup market-based companies for them, and mentorship along with capacity building. So we try to take a full ecosystem approach in how we support a young person who's interested in working on the ocean in an innovative way, from pilot seed stage to an idea, whether it's on a grassroots level to raise awareness about a certain issue, or whether you want to create the next great organization, product, or service. So it's a pleasure to be here. I'm really excited to tell you more about what we do and meet you all after.
Thanks, Brandon.
Hi, everyone. My name is Anita Krishnamurthy, and I'm the Senior VP for STEM and Youth Engagement at an organization here in DC called the After School Alliance. We are an after school advocacy organization, and so you might be wondering what the heck I am doing here on this panel. But the reality is that STEM learning in after school has really taken off, and after school programs around the country serve about 10 million young people. It's a space that really centers youth voice and youth development and is very, very youth-centered. And so recognizing all of these trends, we've launched a new initiative that we're calling the Collective for Youth Empowerment in STEM and Society, which I think is a slide that may eventually come up. So you can check out the slide and the website and the information there for more on what we do and our projects. But what we're really trying to do is support more programming at the intersection of teen leadership, civic engagement, and STEM. And as you might imagine, sort of sustainability and the environment are very much a part of what a lot of programs are targeting, including action around the oceans. So I'm delighted to be here and tell you a little bit more about our work, but also really excited to see so many young people here and to engage with you and look forward to your questions and to interacting with you after the panel as well.
Thank you. And I just want to, I know it's at the beginning, but I do want to give them just a round of applause. And again, thank everybody for sharing this space with us right now. So I'm going to give them just a round of applause. So Anita, you actually gave us the first question, right, that we're going to address to Finn. So we're going to get the youth perspective on how can we expand the narrative around STEM to include civic engagement and use this action tool to center the needs of young people? Kind of a loaded question, so you can think a little bit.
So where I'm from in my town, we're on the water, on the ocean, and there's a large, like, there's a community really around just like water sports and the summer, like getting on the beach and swimming. And so like I find, especially with my personal experience, there's a lot of like value in promoting, like taking, if you show a kid like the beach, and then if there's a problem with the beach, let's say like sand erosion around the dunes, showing them ways that their involvement can directly positively affect that that area, I think that has a large impact on students or young kids, especially. I mean, firsthand experience, it happened to me with an institution institutions that I work for. So I think like really showing kids that their actions have a direct positive effect on the environment, whether it be getting them involved in research or getting them involved in classes through school that look at examples of companies or entrepreneur experiences founded by college kids or the younger generation that have had an effect on the ocean. Because I think we're coming to a point where we're realizing that like things are not good with the climate and ocean health. And when kids see that, they're gonna be more motivated to get involved, and like the culture around being like it being cool to be like a marine science kid in high school is gonna really start to expand.
I was never cool, so thank you, Finn. Actually, Kawika, I would actually like your take on that. You know, how does Kupu do a lot of that civic engagement?
So I'm thinking of two different sayings. One is probably more broadly familiar with anyone who's a parent around here, and you can remember, I remember the saying, show them, don't tell them, right? When you want, when you've got a little one and you're trying to teach them the basic things, and as my kids, my son is now taller than me, I find it's just as important, right? To not lecture at, but to show. In the Hawaiian language, we have a saying that is makahana ka ike, which means the knowledge is in the doing. What I'm getting at here with both of those points is if we want to show, right, the connection between civic engagement, the challenges in the environment around us, and things like STEM, right, I think the best way to do it is to get people involved in the process. Right, so things like helping people see the connection between the environment around them and the legislation that is passing or that keeps dying at their local legislature, right? To see the connections between regulation and outcomes, right? It's not enough to just talk about these things. I think we also need to get young people and people of all ages, frankly, because that kind of disconnection and disengagement is not just a youth problem. It's a national problem and it's a global problem right now. So to connect people with those issues and get them involved in fixing things, I think there's a lot of knowledge in that doing.
Thank you. I have something for you, Marie, because that leads us to this next question of getting youth involved in different ways. So you're with the Corps, so how are you working to provide field opportunities for youth and really reframing the definition of service? Because a lot of times community service, think about, and you don't have to say it out loud, what do you think of when you think of community service and youth doing community service, and maybe not in a positive way? Because I know with some of the youth we work with, we actually do bring in people who are doing community service because of something they've done, and we've tried to kind of shift the narrative of what they're doing. So what are you doing with the Corps?
Well, like Kawika's Corps in Hawaii, there are, like I said, over 150 service and conservation corps. But the word service, like you said, kind of sometimes doesn't always have the most positive spin on it. And so that's what we've tried to do. We have young people that are working on, just like the title says, community stewardship of protected waters. Can be community stewardship over wherever you may be doing all of those types of projects. We have young people that are working in some of the best and finest national parks in the country. We have some working on Forest Service lands that are doing what they need to do to help enhance, to protect, to grow, to nurture in their communities. And I also think that one of the most important parts is when you have young people that actually do work in their community, they take pride in that. They see what they've done. And they also want to bring their friends to see what they've done. I can think of other stories of some of the corps across the country have seen what their friends, the park that they worked in to restore. And they brought their friends to the park and they said, what, you did this? And they said, yeah, we built those benches. We cleared that debris. We worked in this park to make it a community landmark. And so I think it's the pride that we miss when we talk about service, that the young people believe in their communities and give back to their community. And therefore, they enjoy living in that community.
Great, thank you. Finn, I saw your head kind of doing this throughout the day. So I'm assuming you agree with her. Are there examples of what you've seen besides yourself of other youth, maybe your friends getting involved because they see you or they see other individuals? Have you seen that as well?
Yeah, with my institution in my town, when we first started, it was a four-person team, and we were doing research and like getting out swimming in the ocean and like sampling plants and water samples. And like my friends would be like, oh, what'd you do today? Or like, how's your weekend? And some kids would be like, oh, I slept in, and then I would be like, oh, yeah, I got out, and I was swimming in the ocean at 5:30 in the morning. And kids at first were like, ooh, that 5:30, but, and then you take them to, we took them, a bunch of my friends, to the our little lab, and we showed them, like, a tank. We'd built these tanks to house plants, and we were like, yeah, we spent our summers just, like, cutting and shaping like tanks and running pipe systems, and it's all like hands-on work. And I found a lot of my friends were like, wow, like this is really cool. And then our team has grown and grown and grown, and like a lot of kids from our school have come to the institution, not joined necessarily our team, but founded other projects just so they could get out and do something and go and tell their parents and their friends, like, I'm doing this for my town, and like this is the research and this is how it's helped. So I've definitely seen growth just from other kids finding it, like I said, cool and getting
it's
involved.
It's the new wave of peer pressure. That's what I say. It's a good one. That takes me to a question I have for you, Anita.
Sure.
Is we've heard a lot about these programs, right? And you are the After School Alliance, and we've seen that especially with COVID. They came into play where these after school programs are really essential for getting kids involved. Because there's so many other things going on in the classrooms, sometimes those after-school programs can be not just a safe haven for a lot of individuals. I know at least in the community that we live in, but also just a way to see cool things, right? That are not, you're not going to get tested on them, and they're not going to get a grade. It doesn't affect your GPA. So, can you tell us a little bit about the programs that you guys have funded that really kind of stood out to you as kind of those, just anything that stands out to you?
Sure. So we're not a funder. I just want to.
I'm sorry.
Like, we advocate for public funding for after-school programs, sort of at the federal and state levels. But yes, absolutely. You know, after-school programs are very much a place that can feel different as an engagement and learning environment than a regular school day, right? Like, I mean, wonderful things happen in schools, but after-school programs are often free of some of the constraints that schools have to deal with on a day-to-day basis. And just like Finn was saying, I think it's a wonderful way to really center community contexts and tackle issues that and interests that young people might have that are very rooted in their local communities and make that kind of learning and engagement come alive. And as I'm sure all of you know and talk about, especially you, Suraida, when I heard about your STEM education background, right? Like, this is a thing that the country is very interested and invested in. But at the end of the day, I think we have to remember that this is about young people. It's not about American competitiveness or the economy. It's about helping young people gain this tool that they can use to live their lives, to use it in any way that they choose to, some of which might be professional, but it's a tool that we all need to use and understand as citizens in this country to make informed choices and decisions. And so I think after-school programs are a great way to engage with that kind of learning, because as you said, they're not afraid of tests and being assessed very rigorously or regularly in these settings. And that's not to say learning is not happening. There's some amazing learning that's happening. So I'll throw out one example. One of our partners in the CS initiative, they work a lot with high school students over the summer on GIS data mapping. And this is not necessarily ocean related, but so the kids, the young people select capstone projects. So one of them that did some work around coastal degradation in Florida and sort of mapping how the GIS data set sort of mapped to that so that they can go advocate for that in their local lawmakers about steps that could be taken. But another cool one that I really enjoyed hearing about was young people in a low-income community noticed that there weren't a lot of healthy food options in their communities, and they mapped the prevalence of the fast food options in their community versus those in a more affluent community, and were able to sort of really use that data to then go to their city council and say, how come we don't get any of these fresh food options that the young people in the more affluent areas are getting, and really bring about that change? And I think, as Finn was saying, right, the ability to make change is very powerful and it's very empowering. And sorry, Marie, maybe you were the one who said that, but it's very empowering to recognize that you have agency and you have a voice and it takes active engagement, but it's also a muscle that needs to be developed and built because otherwise it can feel very intimidating and scary to do that. So really what we're trying to do through our work is to support young people to develop that muscle in small ways, in big ways, in hyper-local community issues or global issues like ocean health, and figure out how do we support more adults to really be able to center youth voice in this kind of learning and engagement. And I think after-school programs are a great space to be able to do that kind of learning and teaching.
Mm-hmm. So before I go to Brandon, so I didn't coach them or anything, but they've been doing awesome, like giving me little conduits to what's the next question, because then that brings me to Brandon, right? So you mentioned a little something, and I don't want to butcher it, right? You talked about how organizations really should function more like nature. Mm-hmm. Can you tell us a little bit more about what you meant by that? And how that works in the organization?
Absolutely, yeah. I think we were geeking out on this in our panel prep call, but the core aspect of this, I mentioned that Sustainable Ocean Alliance has one of the largest networks of young people in the world, right? We have young people in over 150 countries. They organize in hubs. What's really incredible about the network is it is structured in a way where authority is distributed, it is youth-led, it is locally attuned, as you were mentioning. And we do our best in the architecture of that network itself to mimic what we see in self-organizing systems in nature, because those systems are most effective and efficient. If you look at a beehive, shoals of birds, shoals of fish, or murmurations of birds, mycelium underground. There are many examples of how nature is the best designer for resilience. And when you try to create an effective community, why not model it after ecosystems with their 3.4 billion years of R&D of really functioning on a very high level? So how that works in practicality at SOA is we do our best to have as much distributed leadership as possible. If you look at any self-organizing system in nature, it doesn't have top-down authority. It doesn't function like a machine. Most of our systems, whether it's government or military or whatever else, are following this mechanistic logic where there's strict top-down hierarchies, right? But in nature, no such thing exists. So we try to find the right level of support from headquarters to federate the structure where young people can self-organize. And in the latest in complexity science, which is a fascinating discipline, they discover the most effective systems in nature have the right combination of both order and randomness. So you have to have enough order where it's not everything's just, you know, pure chaos, but enough room for randomness that innovation can happen. So when you look at a line of ants, right? If you step on the line of ants, the ones that are a little random, the ants that are not, you know, totally orderly, that are maybe going adjacent, those are going to be the most resilient to then create a new ant line, right? So how in our community and how we design all of our networks can we learn from nature in this way? So for example, we don't try to be overly didactic or prescriptive to our young leaders. We trust that they are locally attuned to what's going on in their communities, and we just provide the guardrails to keep things on track and making sure the impact goals more broadly for ocean health are being met, but with enough freedom and autonomy on all the levels, on the regional, national, and local levels for effective ocean action to happen. So we organize our communities we have a global community of young people with about 6,000 youth. Then we have regional representatives. These are top performing young leaders who speak the language of their bioregions and communities and run their own programs and events. We have one right here who's filming, Mark Haver from North America. You can find him by the booth outside. But Mark runs our North America community. And within our North America community, we have hubs through different universities. And we provide grants and funding and mentorship to these individuals. But we're not saying, hey, you have to sign this petition and do this project. It's like, what is most important in Charleston, South Carolina, or Santa Barbara, right? So as much as we can learn from nature, let's do it.
Great. So I love that analogy of it, and I think that's almost with everything, even with technology, is that nature has all the answers already. We think we're innovative, and then we go out, we're like, oh, nature's already done that. So those were the questions that I really had for the panel as far as like very specific questions. But throughout the week, I've had the honor and the opportunity of hanging out with some young folk. And I say y'all, can y'all tell where I'm from? Texas, yeah, Texas. So if I say y'all, it's because that's where I'm from. So I did want to make sure that we covered or at least addressed those questions that were posed by youth. I didn't even see these. This is a lot of stuff, oh my gosh. But I did promise, I don't know if Mahek, I can't really see you because there's like a light in my face. Oh, okay, Mahek. So Mahek had had a really great question, right? And she had, what advice, and you're more than welcome to, or I can just pick on you. So it's kind of like class. If you don't raise your hand, I'm going to pick on you. What advice do you have for international students who are barred from many internship and research opportunities in the US due to their visa status, but want to build a career in this field? Does she stump us all?
Yep, you got us.
What did you tell her, Evelyn? That maybe she could. I think maybe she had an answer. So, what was the answer that you gave Mahek?
To create your own opportunity. Yeah. It may not be there, but it doesn't mean you can make your own path.
I don't know. I didn't have, even when she posed it to me in person. Unless somebody else in the audience has one. Nobody on here. You wanna?
I'll take a stab. I agree with that line of logic. I think it's a total shame how stringent and unnecessarily draconian some of these laws are that prevent young people from other countries to coming to, let's say, international fora for ocean policymaking. We've seen it time and time again with the international events that we've run. So we are doing our best to try to create opportunities for young people that can't be there in person or build relationships with governments to ease the path. But I totally agree. I mean, there is room for us to take any form of limitation or climate anxiety or whatever it is and move it into agency. So at SOA, we try to be a platform for that. We do provide grants up to $15,000. We've seen young people from over 67 countries build projects out of that, which then go on to be larger organizations and community building initiatives that then support other people. So there are ways, at least with our organization and many others, that we can give you that seed funding to start creating your own opportunities. But I do think education is really important, and it's hard when you are barred, so it is a disadvantage, but there are ways to continue building yourself through other opportunities that exist, and then that may ease the path to gain access to some of these more prestigious institutions.
Thank you so much. And maybe just have to, maybe that's a deeper conversation back that we need to have. So thank you for posing that. Another question that we had, I think it was pretty prevalent because I know I'm still paying for my college and I'm 47. College is expensive and many youth are choosing to work and gain experience versus going the traditional academic route. What are you doing to adapt to the changing workforce where young adults do not necessarily have a master's or a PhD? So I don't know if, do you want to take it? How about, yeah, you want to try us, take a stab at it, or I can give it to Marie?
I think you give it to Marie, because really, like, we work on programs for much younger.
I feel like I'm in class, like, oh no, she can answer it. She can answer it.
I get the hard question. Or maybe the second hardest. I think the first one was the hardest.
Yeah, I wanted to pose that one.
I think that it's a way to adapt. I think that young people don't always want to go to college or don't always want to get a master's degree. But I think there are a million other types of jobs and work, even federal jobs. We have a lot of young people that work in CORES that have worked on public lands that now have the opportunity to go into a permanent job placement with one of the federal land management agencies. And I think Kawika can speak to this a little bit more. But and it didn't take a college degree, but I do recommend that if you do go to college and you are working with one of the Corps, participate in one of the Corps' AmeriCorps programs. The AmeriCorps program will give you scholarship monies once you complete a certain amount of hours that you can that can help you pay for some of your college education, mm-hmm. just in case if that's what you wanted to do. But I do think that there is room to do a lot of other types of work that don't necessarily require a college degree that can allow young people to work on public lands, whether it's lands or waterways, that can do that type of work. Because the young people are resilient. They're gonna find a way. They're gonna make a way. And I think that the educational system, you know, back in my day, I had no other choice but to go to college. Mm. But young people, you do have options. And find out what those are. Sometimes they may not come knock on your door. You may have to crawl and go through the weeds to find that opportunity. But those opportunities are there. Right. Kawika, you may be able to.
I'd agree with what you said. I also was thinking about, I think everyone's probably heard the term college age, right? Mm. And I think that term is going to become increasingly irrelevant. Mm. You know, it speaks to a time period or a model of the world where college was this thing that you went to right after high school, you took care of it, you did whatever amount of it you were gonna do all at once, and then you went out into the workforce. Mm-hmm. One of the things that I would say for folks who have that concern, you know, college is something that we're probably going to continue to go back to, like in bits and bytes along the way. Mm-hmm. I think especially in conservation, which is, you know, the heart or the majority of the types of jobs that we're helping young people get, conservation is something that is best to look at in terms of its career pathway, right? I can think of folks in our program who went to college, came out, participated in Kupu, emerged with scholarship money, a paid job, mm-hmm. and then, you know, they started doing something like conservation technician. And that was something that made them happy for a couple of years, but then they decided, you know what, I don't want to just do the day-to-day work. I want to make decisions about how this whole park is taken care of. So then they would go back and they would get their master's in public administration or something else. We've got other folks that start their work, you know, doing marine resource care, and then they end up becoming conservation scientists. Well, that is gonna require some going back to school, right? But you can do it over the course of your career pathway, and where you start isn't necessarily where you finish. Mm-hmm. And there's hopefully a very long and rewarding journey if what you choose to do is pursue a job that reflects your sense of your life's calling, which I think is why a lot of us who are attracted to conservation, sustainability, and public service, that's why we are where we are.
If I can just piggyback on that, I think there's also an option around apprenticeships, right? Like the Department of Labor, for example, there's a lot of different monies and funding streams that go into supporting apprenticeships for young people who don't necessarily want to go to college. And I think, Kawika, you made an excellent point that I think the way we think of learning has had to change for a long time, but it's really got to change now, right? Like, because we've totally entered an era where that learning has to be continuous. It's not getting a degree and done. Things are changing so rapidly around us. And I mean, I certainly grew up in a time when it was a very linear thing. You know, I went to college, I went to grad school, and then I got a job. But I'll just say that, you know, I started my life and my career as a research astronomer. I have a PhD in astrophysics, and now I work for an after-school advocacy organization. Life takes you in a lot of random directions, and it's about being open to opportunities that present themselves and what interests you. And so this is the one thing I always try to say to young people is do the thing that interests you in the moment, because that will lead to the next thing. And that next thing might be the same, or it might be related, or it might be really different. But it's just having a sense of curiosity and openness to learning is the key thing. And I think that's even more important these days, where getting a degree doesn't mean you are then done with the learning phase. You might continue learning on your job, go back to school, learn through volunteer roles. There's lots of different ways to continue gaining that learning.
Great. Thank you all so much. We have some questions for the audience that I want to make sure I interject in here, and this one's for Finn. I know you've already alluded to a lot of things that you've done, so we have a high school student here who says, how do I make a bigger impact in what's happening now? And how can I continue to progress my way into the marine science community? So maybe a little bit more specific examples of what you've done and then how that's really led to the different opportunities that you've had.
Yeah, sure. So I started, I got involved, the institution in my town's called Cohasset Center for Student Coastal Research, CSCR for short. And so I got involved with them my freshman year of high school. One of my friends who was the project leader approached me and said, hey, this summer we want to study eelgrass, which is a plant in our harbor. And I was wondering if you'd like to join the team or if you have any ideas on what you want to do. And so we came up with an idea for studying salinity and wasting disease and all sorts of stuff revolving around eelgrass. But that study kind of evolved into, we applied for like all sorts of funding and research grants. And through that, we made some connections with some people up at MIT, some people in like Woods Hole Institute. I find that like expanding your, like the work you do with environmental science, it comes down a lot to connections, like meeting the right people. Through that work, I met one of the board members of CSCR, who recommended I check out Stellwagen Bank National Marine Sanctuary, which is why I'm here today. So I think like science tends to be like a very communal activity. There's a strong community around science. There's a lot of communication. Scientists talk to each other from across the globe. So once you start to get into that field, like reaching out to people who have done similar research, reaching out to people who are experts in something that you want to try or something that you want to experiment with, and then like establishing and fostering relationships with these people and seeing where that takes you, I think is probably one of the best ways to get like really into marine science as a high school student or college student even.
Thank you. And I know, Anita, you had also alluded very similar. It's like every action you take leads to a different opportunity.
For sure. Right?
And so, you know, as Finn was saying, we just get involved. And I heard something that's like, if you're planning for it, you're not doing it. If you're talking about it, you're not doing it. If you're writing down and making a plan for it, you're not doing it. Like, you just need to do it. And that's an advice for myself, too. But yeah, just to be able to do that. And you never know where it's going to lead you. And there wasn't a name, so I didn't see who that was. We have like 60, so I do want to address one. I think this is a great one. So this is to any of you who want to answer this. It says, what would you say to young people that are frustrated because older generations don't listen to them and don't take them into account? Sorry, I'm not kidding. When making decisions that affect their future.
I agree. That's how I would start. I think, you know, and then not to use this space to talk about something, a story of folks that aren't young anymore, right? But I'd mentioned earlier for Kupu, we started because our founders came home at 22 years old and they didn't see an organization that fit their vision and their hopes for their home. So they made an organization to do that. And I think if you would have asked John, Juliana, and Matt at 23, you know, 1 year in, how's it going? Did you fix everything? They'd tell you no, and they'd tell you they're still frustrated, and there's still so much work to do, right? And if you ask them the next year, you'd get a different version of the same type of answer. For their journey, for Kupu's journey, the impact took time. There was meaning and value and joy in the work along the way, but it took time to get to where we are today, where we have over 6,000 alumni that have gone through our jobs and paid national service opportunities. John and Matt can tell you about the first invasive grasses that they pulled. Today, our crew has collectively removed over 151,000 acres of invasive grasses and are now focused on doing that in a way that tries to prevent future tragedies like the firestorm, the wildfire that devastated the town of Lahaina on the island of Maui last year. Now, all of these things, right, there's joy in the work in front of you. That's one thing that I would urge you to look at. But then also to be honest about it, it's gonna take time. If it's frustrating now, it's probably gonna stay frustrating for a little while, but we can all get there.
And
No, go ahead.
I was just gonna say, and you know, that's exactly why we launched our CS initiative, is because I hear you, it is very frustrating, and it's not, you know, and I am all for much more intergenerational conversations and intergenerational problem definition as well as solving, right? Like, how do we all come together and set sort of community agendas together and recognize that each generation is bringing a different set of experiences and lived experiences and expertise to the table? And so what I'd offer up is there are people like us out there in your communities who believe in this. And so look for them. It's you know, we're all in this fight together to really try and change this narrative and really try and socialize and normalize giving young people genuine voice in these conversations. There's many of us out there trying to do this. So I hear you, it is frustrating. As people doing this work, it can be frustrating as well, because you know we fight this alongside you. But try and find us. We're out there and we're trying to do this, both with you and for you.
Absolutely. If I could add to that, how many of you are 21 or?
We got a couple of 21s.
Or older. Wait. So what I'm in the, I have an AARP card, so that tells you how old I am. So, but I've been your age. I hear what you're saying. And just like Anita said, we've been there. So I think the thing to do is persevere. You're resilient. Don't give up. Yes, it's frustrating. I thought the same thing when I was 21. Yeah. But you've got to keep moving forward. Don't let it get you, you get it.
Yeah. Nice. And the folks that you're frustrated at, right,
yes.
Who are making decisions that affect our present and our future, they would probably love for you to go from frustrated to disengaged.
Mm-hmm.
Because that means that there's no threat to what they're doing and their power, right? Mm-hmm. So just building off of it, right? And I think I just jumped in front of you, so I'm gonna turn over to you now, right? But like, don't go from frustrated to disengaged. Use that frustration as fuel. It is energy. It can be catalyzed and transformed into action, and action leads to change.
Amen. Yes. Yeah, and I round of applause for that. Yeah, no, I totally agree. The doom and gloom narratives don't support any of us. They are inherently disempowering. And I do agree. I think there's so much power in communal action. Our voices are way louder and mightier when we come together. And we see more and more of a social movement around the ocean taking place at SOA, at all these amazing organizations, civil society coming together. As it relates to some of the intergenerational divides, there was a study at a Harvard recently studying thousands of young people between 18 and 25 years of age. And one of the top thing that emerged from the study was that young people feel a sense of intergenerational injustice, which I get. It makes sense. And as you were saying, from firsthand experience, it's always been youth at the forefront of building progress. We are raising the consciousness. We have more access to information. We are perhaps the first and last generation that can do something about this problem, right? So it is a very empowering situation to be in. So patience, just as our parents had with us when we were annoying 12, 13-year-old kids, you know, let's have with them. How many of you feel like you're now educating your parents and folks about issues like climate change? Okay. Well, I noticed the young people are raising hands. That's good. Yeah, and I think we have to continue to be the educators and have patience and understand that their worldviews may be different. They may have come up at a time where the internet wasn't there, the same level of access to information wasn't there, and there wasn't as much, perhaps, scientific awareness of what the impact they were having. Not to excuse the boomers and all the other generations, but we can't make it like an us versus them. There's so much we can learn from our elders as well. When you look at indigenous tribes and wisdom keepers, young people do not have all the answers. We have ingenuity, we have the energy to actually face these, but we need to also do this in collaboration with our elders and both be educated and educating simultaneously.
Thank you all. That was very enlightening. And then also for the person who asked, you know, ask those questions. All of these questions, I'm hoping that you're asking your local community. This is a great opportunity to ask at CHOW. There's a lot of folks here. If you're here, you're probably already ahead of the game. There's a lot of individuals who couldn't be here for different reasons, which leads me to this question in just a second. But just use your voice. A lot of times it's like it is frustrating. And as I said, it doesn't kind of stop. And it's especially frustrating for Black, Brown, and Indigenous folk because there's a whole other layer to that. And I can tell you it even happens like now in my space where it can be very frustrating. But I love what you said. Do not let frustration make you get disengaged, because that's exactly what they want, and the systems will never change. And it's only through that persistence, we talked about persistence and, you know, continually to move forward, that's what's going to make the change. As an educator, we plant seeds. And so you got to, you know, we get that. Sometimes you don't get to see those grow. Sometimes you do. But you know that you contributed to that. And so even now, I know I put seeds, and then I see my students doing amazing things in the White House and other places. So what you're doing is making an impact. Whether you think it's, you know, planting grass, it's somebody is watching you. It could be your brother or your cousin or other people in the neighborhood, and then they're gonna get involved because you were involved as a young person. So again, do not get discouraged. We have a limited amount of time, but I do wanna address this. There's a lot of questions, and it's not that I didn't think they were important, but we have such a short time right now. We're at 5 minutes or so. I do wanna ask this really quickly. It says, youth in marine conservation science are often expected to volunteer for a while in order to be hired for certain jobs. This inequitable system excludes many youth who do not come from wealthy backgrounds. Do you think this will ever change?
Okay, you're looking at me again.
Oh, I'm just looking, Maria. I just like happened to. You have a beautiful face. You have a beautiful
I think it has changed.
Yeah.
Kawika can probably speak to this better than I can, because he actually has the young people. But they get paid for their work that they do. There is a stipend, a wage, a living allowance, so they get paid for this. So it's not to put young people out doing work and not get paid for it. So they do. The young people that we work with in service and conservation corps, that's part of what makes you a service or conservation corps, is that your members have a living wage.
Yeah, I would say it's changing. It's changed, but it hasn't changed enough.
Yeah.
Right? Because what Kupu does and what other youth service corps do across the country are still the exception to the rule, unfortunately. Mm-hmm. And it continues to be true that young people, whether at various stages of their early career, hit this sort of conundrum where you need experience for the work, but you need the work to get the experience, right? And the folks that are able to overcome that the most easily are people who come from households with resources and wealth so that they can do a voluntary internship, right? That's something that we very much saw in Hawaii when Kupu was getting started. And it was a challenge not only in terms of equity in an income sense, but it was also something that was creating and maintaining this revolving door in Hawaii, where the best conservation jobs, the best marine science jobs, were going to people who weren't from those communities. The revolving door stretched all the way to the US continent and came all the way over to our islands. And sometimes people would come to Hawaii, fall in love with it, and stay. Other times they would go back home somewhere else, and then the next person would come in. Meanwhile, we have local youth, local communities, local leaders that have intergenerational ancestral wisdom, mm-hmm. love and care for these same islands, and they're being separated from the best opportunities to serve them. We wanted to change that. And so that was why we ended up participating with the CORE Network and pursuing our first AmeriCorps grant many, many years ago. Today, we're the largest AmeriCorps grantee in the state of Hawaii and in the US-affiliated Pacific. And so we're able to provide some resources, but that's even still a challenge, right? So I think it's gotten better. It hasn't gotten good enough. And we all need to keep pushing. You need to keep pushing at your level. We need to keep pushing at ours to make our organizations better and more just and more equitable. And all of us need to work together to bring more resources to these areas.
All right. So we have 2 minutes. And again, actually, I really like this question, but I know we won't be able to answer it. Just quickly, is there any final thoughts, literally 10-second thoughts that you have? You want to go, Finn? Yeah.
I was going to say that I think there's a lot of questions around specific youth involvement activities. And I am running out of time here. If anyone would like to talk to me right after this, I am available for any, especially high schoolers or youth, or just come up and want to talk specifics or my story or their story. I'm very more than happy to.
Thanks, Finn.
I would say get out in your local community. You can make the difference.
Yeah. Don't give up. This is the fight of our generations. And what we do now or what we don't do will echo into the far, far distant future, long after we're gone. Don't give up.
Building on that, there's a great quote, despair is an insult to the imagination. So trust in the creative prowess within your ingenuity, everything that you have inside of you to make a difference in the world.
I was going to say something about despair as well.
Don't be despairing.
No, despair is not an option, right? Giving up is just simply not an option. And for those of us who are privileged enough to be in a position where we can fight, it is our responsibility to fight. Giving up is just not an option.
Mm-hmm. And I got 16. So I always tell my students that a lot of us will never fit into spaces because those spaces were never created for us. But it's okay. It's okay that if you don't fit, because what happens when you fit something into somewhere it doesn't fit, you have to change it. And so that means changing who you are. Mm-hmm. So we belong everywhere. It doesn't matter if you're black, if you're young, indigenous, brown, you belong in those spaces. So make sure that you understand that. There is a difference between fitting in and belonging. And that's belonging is something that nobody can take away from you, right? Once you know who you are, nobody can tell you who you are. Mm-hmm. And so that's very important, to all of us intergenerationally, to make sure that we understand that. Because all of who we are, when we bring that into that space, you will see it doesn't drain you. When you have to constantly change who you are to be and fit in a space and to be accepted, it doesn't work. You work in a space because that's who you are, and you bring all of you into that space. Mm-hmm. We want to thank our panelists for all their amazing answers to the questions. Thank you, all of you, for all these questions. We are going to give them to Joe, who's going to come on in just a second, so don't leave. But again, just can we give him a round of applause for him? Thank you.
Sorry, Joe, I took your spot.
No, no worries. Hello, hello, hello. Good to see everyone again, and thank you for that incredible conversation and panel. Thank you so much, Suraida, for moderating the panel, and I understand you brought your young daughter with you all the way from Texas.
Yes.
To join us, so hello, welcome. So it is my pleasure to introduce Leslie Ann Pierce-Roman to provide the closing remarks. Leslie Ann is 19 years old. She's Puerto Rican, raised in Brooklyn. She is a Macaulay Honor student at the Brooklyn College, and she's quite passionate about the ocean. She's been volunteering since she was just a child at the Wildlife Conservation Society. She serves as a discovery guide and a youth ocean advocate. She educates the public on environmental issues, and she's worked on the petition to help make Hudson Canyon a national marine sanctuary. As an ocean protection ambassador with Earth Echo International, Leslie Ann empowers young environmental activists to take action and appreciate our blue planet. Please welcome Leslie Ann.
Good afternoon, everyone. I just wanted to say I'm very honored to be here, and thank you to the panelists for an amazing discussion. As Joel said, my name is Leslie Ann Pierce, and I, along with the wonderful people on this stage, are the product of what it means to have an accepting and rewarding workforce. But it's not just us. Each one of you sitting here today is a part of this workforce, contributing to the cause of environmental advocacy in your own unique way. At the age of 14, I was introduced to the Wildlife Conservation Society through my local aquarium. The programs they offer were not just educational, but also limitless in their potential. They equipped us with the necessary tools for success, from networking to team collaboration. Our shared passion for the environment created a space where diverse perspectives and shared beliefs can converge into a beautiful whole. In the environmental community, the inclusion of youth in our workforce is not just essential for protecting the environment, but also for designing programs that will be better for future generations. This is the true reason we are all gathered here today. As a young Puerto Rican woman with a deep love for the ocean, I had faced discouragement when I first embarked on my journey into environmental advocacy. It, however, was through overcoming these challenges that I experienced a profound shift in my perspective. I realized that if there weren't people like me, I would have to step up and be the change for the future generation of young girls. This realization has opened up a world of endless opportunities for me, from being a part of the first ever youth planning team hosted by NOAA, to spearheading a campaign for the Hudson Canyon Marine Sanctuary, which I have the pleasure of being on for 5 years now. This campaign is still in progress, so be tuned for updates. Furthermore, my journey and accomplishment have been possible for the immense support of my parents, peers, and supervisors. The work of the individuals on this stage and in this room is what fuels our collective hope and optimism for the future of our society. As a 19-year-old from New York, I've been able to achieve so much in my short span of time. However, we as a workforce have to take the expectation of age away and have to create a supporting and valuing space where youth can feel heard from every different part of the world, for each have a different story and different perspective to share. And so as we learn about the power of one's voice, no matter where they come from or what age they are, youth voices matter. And so as I end this panel, let us not only be open to the possibility of all ideas and all perspective, but let's actively seek them out. For in the end, it's the diversity of our thoughts and the richness of our perspectives that can lead us to the solutions we would have never thought possible. Thank you.
Thank you, panelists. We'll rise and we'll take a photo. Thank you, everyone. We're going to take a break. We've got a good half hour for you to get refreshed out there. Grab some water, grab some juice or coffee or tea so you can stay sharp. And we will see you here at 3 p.m., 3 o'clock for our next plenary. So don't be late. We'll see you then. Thank you all.